Hello everyone and welcome to my, well, is it the third stream now? I think it's the third stream, and I am so glad that so many of you have joined. It's really fantastic. I see so many names here. I can see, I've been communicating with Nicole. I can see she's in at Sasha. I can see Belladonna. This time I got your name right. And it's absolutely delighting. I'm absolutely delighted to see so many. We've got already 50 there. And I hope through the weeks we can increase the number of viewers. If you haven't subscribed, please subscribe. We're going to keep this up to date every day. You can see we are engrossed here in Eagles. This is your channel. It's particularly tailored really to talk about Eagles in North America. And you know what delighted me last week? What really delighted me? I joined the Northeast Florida nest, and my goodness, there's so much tension. So you know it all, right? You know that there has been a pip, which means there's a crack now in the shell of the first egg. And I think from all the webcams across North America, this is the first one, the Northeast Florida nest. And I got a lot of incredible information from Gretchen. I'll mention her later. She seems to be the guard of the Northeast Florida nest, and we're going to feature it today. So really exciting. Wonderful. So that's the first sign, and there, I think it's about a week to 10 days early. Wonderful statistics. We're going to talk a bit about statistics today. So the way I want to run this on a weekly basis, and let me just get here on my screen quickly. Yeah, there we are. I'm sunk a bit away. I hope you can all, yes, it was a pip. So you can all hear me. I hope you hear me loud and clear. Everything's fine. I see Susan, my goodness, I see so many of my friends here. All the comments coming in. I'm absolutely delighted. So this is Eagle News across North America. My name is Christian Sasse, SassePhoto. I started with Eagle Photography in 2011 with a small camera. I was, you could say, David Hancock is my mentor, the absolute genius when it comes to when it comes to eagle biology. I've learned so much from him. I've been right next to him for many years, and this has been my passion, especially from the technical point of view, to build up something. There are such incredible chats that we have from so many different areas now, especially in, I'm absolutely impressed on the East Coast. You have an incredibly large chat room that is very well managed in the Northeast Florida nest. I've seen Barry is incredible with their own live stream, and not, it's not YouTube, it's live stream. And then we have the Southwest Florida from, of course, from the real estate. It's, I think it's Dick Pritchett is his name, right? So there's so many, loud and clear, you can hear me. That's great. Osprey Mama's there. Maybe Lady Hawk is also there. I've seen lots of incredible contributions also from Lady Hawk, especially when it comes to the Southwest Florida. So really exciting stuff. So this is my plan of how to run this. I want to do this on a weekly basis. And if we can get more and more of you involved, what I would like to do is grow the community through all the nests here in North America, and not only combine the chat groups, but to see if we can't find the statistics from 2017 to 2018. Now we have the first pip here in the Florida nest, in the Northeast Florida nest. If we can consolidate all that information together, similar to what Belladonna's doing, what Gretchen's doing, and so on. You know, all marvelous jobs. If we can consolidate all that information, we're going to eventually get incredible statistics. I will talk more about statistics later. Yes, it's Dick Pritchett Real Estate. That's right. So we will get more and more information. And that information is incredibly important. So do remind me, I want to talk a lot about statistics, also the work that Gretchen has been doing, and Belladonna and many others, Nicole, of course. So much incredible information. So the way I'm going to run it is I will go through previous nests. So we're going to run quickly through the Southwest Florida nest. We're going to run quickly then through the, I'm just going to go aside so you can see the eagle. I'll talk a bit about this water eagle. That's my own creation, by the way. That's the water eagle in the background. It's my art creation. I'm not an artist, but I love the combination of water and eagles. So the idea then is to go through each nest. And every week we take a new nest on board. So it's going to grow the information, and I need to consolidate that. So what I would like to do is to kindly ask you if there's anybody from each nest who can volunteer to help me put weekly information together. At the moment, it takes me a whole day to consolidate the information. It's a lot of work for me. But if it's possible to get experts, you know, who just send me an email, and my email, I'm just going to quickly blend in now. Sorry, here we go. That's my email, sassephoto@gmail.com. So if I could get someone from the Southwest Florida, from the Northeast Florida nest, from Barrie, and from the Trio nest, and so on. If we could, if I could get one person who just consolidates the information for me, pictures anything interesting, has Pa brought in a huge branch, has there be a barred owl attack, and so on, all these interesting things, because that will help me put it all together. I'm putting, making this completely voluntary, and hopefully this channel becomes increasingly popular with your contribution, so we can make some new effort across North America. That's the you can for Barrie. I see Sasha does. So I have one volunteer here for Barrie. That's great. So that's Sasha. If I could find someone for Northeast, Southwest, that would be great, right? Really, really incredible. Okay, well, let's get going. So I'm going to switch. I just quickly wanted to show you this incredible, let me get my head out of the way. Get the incredible, this is the Nest, that's the 360 camera. It's the only 360 camera. If you haven't seen it, it's nighttime there in Southwest Florida. So that is, I'm rotating this with a touch screen here, so you can see they got the only, to my knowledge, the only 360 camera that there is, really marvelously done. Congratulations to the Southwest Florida Nest to implement this. Really fantastic. Okay, so if you let me just jump now to my news. So I will go in here
with
quickly.
A touch screen.
So
here,
so here you is can Dick Pritchett's
the only
page.
To my,
okay, so for, I'm sure you all know that. Where I'm jumping
that
straight to, so you
really
can see this,
done,
is they have this,
this
page
to the
called
Florida
Weekly Nest
to,
Notes,
to,
and that's incredible. So if I could get
really
someone
fantastic.
From the Southwest Florida Nest to give me weekly updates, what is absolutely
so
here, let me just go to the live feed. Yes, I love this. We have the Hatchwatch 2017. It's a countdown of eggs. So what you see here is egg number one is due in 15 days. If you put 50 days from our day to day, you come right on Christmas Day. So it's going to be a wonderful Christmas present. Let's hope so. Two eggs again for Southwest. So really, really incredible, exciting what's going on there. Lots of beautiful news, very well run. By the way, beautifully run chat room. You can see at the moment 750 people in the Southwest watching the camera now, and they have a very dedicated people. So try and join as many chat rooms as you can. Beautifully run. They've been all incredibly helpful for me. Whenever I needed information, they flooded me with information. Oh, is there no audio? So there should be audio. I'm hearing double audio. Okay, sorry. Okay. We got an audio problem. Hang on. Okay, one sec. Double audio. I have an audio problem. One sec. Let me just fix this. Okay, got it. I need to check why we have double audio. I think
double audio. Okay, sorry.
Hang on. Sorry about that. Sometimes I do something silly. Okay, do we still have double? I have to wait. Do we still have double audio now? I know there's a delay. I'm just going to wait. Let's see if I fix the double audio. If not, triple audio. That's even worse. Oh my goodness. Okay, sorry. Looping. Okay, one sec. Okay, I'm going to try and. Okay, if the audio is fixed now.
We still have double audio now.
I'm just going to wait. Hearing audio from a couple.
If I fix the double audio,
yes, you
not,
do. Yes.
Audio, that's even worse.
It's playing old feed. Probably
okay,
have to restart. Oh my goodness.
Sorry,
oh dear. What is going on here? Okay, sorry. Okay, I think I know the problem.
Okay, if the audio.
Okay, sorry. I think I eliminated the problem. I had a window open. Yes. Thanks for telling me the double audio should be gone now. It should be gone. Sorry. I'm not perfect. Try now. See if the audio is gone. And I deeply apologize for that. I apologize. My apologies. Fixed. Thank you. I saw the source. The source was a problem. I'll tell you what. I had the YouTube video on, so I apologize for this mistake and thank you for letting me know. The problem was I had it open on my other computer that was giving a feedback. I found it. And thanks for letting me know. I know now what to watch out for. Sometimes these things happen. The problem is I would have to wear headphones everywhere to hear all this. And sometimes these errors happen. And I'm trying to keep do all this myself. So apologies, I'm not perfect. Okay, I'm all but perfect. Thank you. So just be patient with me. Just be patient, and I'll be fine. Okay. So let's jump back to the 360 to the 360 nest, and let's get on here. Okay. Let's get on. Okay. Okay. Got it. Okay. So now let's go to Barry. This is the Barry nest live. And you can see there that 223. Now what is going on at the Barry nest? My goodness. So they're expecting, if I recall correctly, the hatch, usually they lay eggs somewhere, I think, mid-January or so. And then mid-February, they lay eggs. You can see in Georgia, there's incredible amount of snow. And there are 223 people watching. So it's quite incredible, right? So much snow. And this is heavy, heavy snow. So if you jump to the different cameras, I love this. Of course, it's night. Oh, thanks, DD. Thanks for... thanks. That's great, Didi. I've just got a very nice donation from Didi. I'm very grateful for that because it helps me keep up the feed and give you the best information possible. So thanks for that. So this is the view here of the Barry nest today. They must have had snow all around Atlanta. Look at that. It's got this beautiful illumination. So they got this approach camera looking at the nest, and you got all the white snow reflecting. For somebody who loves optics like I do, there's our nest. Yes, all the Barry fans can jump up now. This is your beautiful nest, right? And Nicole sent me such incredible, she was feeding me with so many beautiful photographs. So I'm going to show you all this now. So here we go. Snowy day is what it has been in. So this is from today. It's absolutely marvelous. We've had a snowy day. So let's go through the pictures quickly. Oh, Rocky there. This is fine. Flying squirrel spooks mom. So I'll just go through the images. So enjoy this. These are all taken in the last days. You can see how much snow is at the Barry nest. It's incredible. So this is, and that's the top view camera, really beautiful. So there's a lot of snow shoveling going on here. Quite incredible. I'm just going to go through all the beautiful pictures. And thank you to Nicole for spending really hours helping me here compile this. And here she says, Dad Barry flying behind nest. Okay, there you go. He's flying behind the nest. And I think somewhere, if you look closely, yeah. Let me just enlarge this. Her arrow there. You can see there is just flying behind the nest. So very meticulous attention here given. Isn't it beautiful? It's snowing in New York. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. That's incredible, isn't it? So that, and then we have more photographs. It's just incredible. So let me just open this one. Oh, here it gets beautiful because... This is from Becky. So I have many beautiful pictures and I want to give credit to all of you. So this here is also from the Barry nest. And I know Gina also sent me some here. This is from Bill, all these brilliant photographers showing these different pictures. And I hope I don't cover anybody's watermarks. Ah, that's wonderful, Gina. Now, Gina's been incredible, by the way. She has sent me tons of the most beautiful images. If you want to see what a good example of photography is, I mean, these are all brilliant. I think it was Max, Gina, and I don't want to miss out on anyone. It was Bill. All the wonderful pictures that you've sent. Absolutely world-class eagle pictures. Really beautiful. There you can see some chewing some. And here, I don't recognize the... Oh, that, I think that's Gina again, right? That's Gina's picture. Right. That was, I think, her watermark. All beautifully, beautifully done here. Absolutely incredible. How do they survive in so much snow? Well, you know, Sherry, That's a great question. I went to Dutch Harbor. Let me just answer that quickly. They are very resilient to snow. They are perfect, actually, in icy conditions. And they can feed on icy food, in fact. It's absolutely incredible. With their talons and beaks, they do very well. So as long as they get food, and you'll actually find the Alaskan eagles are much, much bigger. They do very well in snow. It's not like we do. And I promise you, I was freezing in Dutch Harbor, and they were not. Okay, so let's jump on another beautiful picture here. All these incredible, really, really incredible footage. And let's jump to the next one. Oh, yeah, this was very nice. This is something that Nicole forwarded to me. This is what I would call an event log of Barry. So what she's done here, or whoever compiled this, is an event log all through the years of what happened at the Barry Nest. And we're now waiting for B10 and B11, right? B10 and B11 and maybe B12, who knows, right? We don't know yet because no eggs have been laid, of course, in the barium nest in Georgia so far. But meticulously beautiful data. Congratulations to that. And this is exactly the information that scientists love. I'm a scientist myself. And with these type of data, we can do beautiful analysis and understand the behaviors of eagles much, much better. Then here is a video quickly that Nicole also gave me. And this is a juvie on the nest, also very recent. Typical of juvies, this could, in fact, it looks to me, if I see it correctly, a 3 or 4 year old, because the beak turns yellow with three, and then 3, 4, and as they go to 4 or 5 years, they turn completely, they have this typical white head. And then, of course, their body feathers turn completely black. And then finally, 6 and 7, their tail feathers lose this black rim. And after that, it is not possible anymore to distinguish what age they have. So this is just an invasion here from a juvie. Can be very dangerous. We had this in White Rock, where a juvie destroyed the eggs. I think Ma was absent for 2 or 3 minutes. And then they came in. So it's a beautiful sub-adult, absolutely. And so let me jump back here now to Nicole. My goodness, Nicole, you have sent me tons and tons of pictures, and I'm very grateful. The most recent one I just want to show you, this here, I hope it's gonna, my internet's fast enough. Yeah, here, this is absolutely insane. The typical payload that eagles can carry is 2 to 3 pounds, typical, right? The biggest eagles that David Hancock has seen are just over 14 pounds female, huge, huge. Now this, if this is correct, this information, and this is so difficult to believe because it's, if this hadn't fallen right next to the photographer, I would have said this is not possible. That seems to be a 12 pound, yes, 12-pound branch. Isn't that crazy? A 12-pound branch being brought back to the nest. Absolutely insane, really. Then dropped right next to this photographer. I don't remember his name, but anyway, it's an incredible picture. Obviously too heavy, but it just shows there's so much we don't know about eagles, and citizen science is the most important, because you are all part of citizen science by being part of the chat room and meticulously documenting all these things. These are data that are very valuable, and we learn so much more about eagles that way. So absolutely love this picture. Then what else has she sent me? I'm just going to quickly go here through my Facebook. That was the big branch. Let me see. Oh, yeah, that was this is nice too. Wow. Let me show you this quickly, because this is a nest comparison for Barry 2012 to 2017. If you've ever wondered how nests get so big, look at this. Marvelous. I have never seen a comparison like this before. 2012, look how small it is. 2017, become enormous. So they can easily reach 600, 700, 800, 900, and 1,000 pounds. They just build on, and they make it more and more rigid so that the young ones don't fall out. And that's exactly because what happens, you've seen this so many times, the juveniles with tremendous force, they pound onto the nest, and sometimes it breaks apart completely. So whilst they are practicing to fly and getting their wings and feathers ready, they really pound and destroy the nest. So the parents have to do these nestorations and get on with it. Beautiful picture, really beautiful. 2012 to 2017 comparison. Thank you, Nicole. Really marvelous. And this is again my my encouragement to you. Do send me pictures, information, anything you have from the from different nests. Send it to SassePhoto@gmail.com. Send me information. This is the way you know, we are going to become successful here. Okay, so this was the berry nest. I'm talking here still about the berry nest, in case you're wondering. So let's just see what else. So thank you for that, Nicole. Yes, and then Max Hester, we had him last time. Max made this beautiful picture here. I can't see what that horrible thing is, what what's being carried there for dinner, but it looks delicious, doesn't it? Absolutely delicious. Right, so thanks, Nicole. We just got so much, so I can't go through everything that Nicole showed me, but it just goes on and on. Beautiful images again from today. Isn't it beautiful to see the contrast between Florida and Georgia, right? I mean, you have two states that are next to each other, and look at the difference in weather. It's absolutely incredible. The Southwest eagles can bring more grasses than branches. There you go. Susan said that. And I think that is, of course, due to the environment there, right? I mean, these look more like Douglas fir and these thick fir trees that you have in Georgia, which you don't have in Florida, right? And that's so that's the explanation. And more pictures. You know, I have so much material here that I cannot even go through it, but they're all beautiful. So many, I mean, look at this. I'll just fling through them quickly. Oh my goodness. It's absolutely beautiful. Gina and others who've taken and we had this one before, and so on. So just marvelous, and so on. So let me stop there. Otherwise the berry nest is going to overtake, take over everything here. But thank you again, Nicole, for all the wonderful information. And thank you to all the photographers, Gina, Max, and everybody who's contributing to that. I need more, by the way, from the Southwest Florida nest. Are there any ground photographers with their huge lenses looking up? Send me pictures so that I can feature you. Why do the eagles look more brown than black? They don't look more brown than black, Susan. That is only the first years. They all look very similar later. It's just when they grow up. And remind me of it next time. I will show you how they change colors all the way to 3, 4, 5 years. Okay, so nothing unusual there. They're not different eagles or so, unless they're golden eagle. Well, golden eagle really looks brown, doesn't have the white head. Right, okay, so this was all about that. Just a quick reminder here of the Stewart's trio nest. There was a correction that someone correctly put. A few people said, hey, Christian, it's not correct what you told us last time. You said we cannot run this on Chrome. I completely agree with you and I apologize. That is correct because you have to load the Adobe Flash Player. So if you load the Adobe Flash Player, you can. Just a bit of warning if you do that. So I put that under a comment recently too. If you load the Adobe Flash Player, you may be at risk for hacking. I don't do it. I don't know enough about hacking. Maybe some of you do, but it's just a word of caution. I've read a lot about the Adobe Flash Player. It's going to exit. They're not going to, I think at the end of 2017 or 2018, the Adobe Flash Player is going to become redundant. And it's important just to remember that. You know, you can run it with Chrome. It's just at your own risk. That's what I want to say. But I'm not going, you know, if you think it's fine, just go ahead. But I don't take responsibility for any hacking. This is just my own, you know, my own advice on this. Okay. So, and now, let's jump in straight into the Northeast Florida nest. I mean, this is so exciting. It's so exciting, as you would say. So let's just zoom in on the news today. And this is the news. If you haven't caught this, that's incredible. So it says there, it says, as you can see, we have a pip confirmed. And this is from this morning, 9:24 a.m. Thank you very much. Well done. Congratulations to the Northeast Florida nest. As far as I know, and please correct me. Ah, Eric's also there. Very nice. I just see all the names. Oh, my goodness. I recognize so many of you. That's so nice to see all the chats going on. But I see there from the Northeast Florida nest, so much good work. 1,144 people are online. They have a beautiful chat that is very well managed. They were incredibly helpful. So the way they manage it, I was a bit surprised because I was typing in some, I was new, I was saying, hey, I'm SassePhoto. I want to bring together all the information across the nests from North America. And my goodness, all the admins were so incredibly helpful. And so the way they do it, if you type in a message, it gets delayed. And I thought, why is it delayed? It's quite simple, because the chat room is so full of, you know, so full of people that it is not possible. They have to read. So they actually, what they do is they put a delay in to actually be able to read the information. Isn't that incredible? Well, congratulations to you. I've never known this was even a problem until, of course, it becomes obvious you can't read the comments anymore. So there you go. They have a chat schedule. It's very well monitored. They're always several admins, very helpful. They've given me incredible information, and the star, and without being I don't want to diminish anybody else's efforts, because you're all putting incredible efforts, but the person they all referred to me is called Gretchen, which is a German name, by the way, Gretchen. So I know how to pronounce German very well. There's a, you know, the famous story from Hänsel and Gretchen. So I don't know how it is even pronounced in American, but I do know the German pronunciation. So I hope you understand Gretchen, but that is her name. So they have these three cameras, and let me just launch them. So she comes from the Audubon Society too. She does volunteer work there. I'm just going to launch the PTZ cameras they have. They have three cameras there, if I remember correctly, and really beautiful. So you can see immediately what's going on here. The one camera, and I love cameras. I've brought up cameras with David Kankok myself. Yes, lovely name, Gretchen. I absolutely agree. So one camera is adjacent with direct view into the nest. That seems to be the top camera. One mounted a little bit higher, so that looks right down. So if there's any motion, anything going on with eggs, that is the camera looking. And then there's a third PTZ camera, and I'm just going to try and launch that. Maybe I can manage that. I think that was from, yes, beautiful view from the ground upwards. Now, if you're going to ask me, where is the Northeast Florida nest? The answer is, it is secret for good reasons. It's on private property, and there's an agreement between the American Eagle Foundation and the property manager, or the owners of the private property, not to reveal the location, which I think is completely respectable. That is fine. So I don't know where the nest is, so don't ask me. And I think we should keep it secret. Even if you do know, please don't write the information here in the chat. Just out of respect for the for the people who are running this, it's much better to keep this a secret. So anyway, you have this incredible nest here, and this is the same this nest here. Okay, this is the nest where you have Romeo and Juliet. Now, what incredible names! So let's jump to Gretchen's information now, and let me see if I can find it. One second, Gretchen's information that she sent me. I got to show you this, because I mean, this is, if you ever think a chart is off the charts, this chart is off the charts. Absolutely insane information. So I'm going to zoom in a lot now. So to share this, ever since 2008, Eagleholics, that's what you all are. Ever since 2008, this nest has been monitored from Gretchen with meticulous scientific accuracy. So what is so incredible here, and I'm going to ask Gretchen to send me some more information, but I'll do that privately, is you can see that It seems this is the same pair. It's coming to the 10th year now. Ever since 2008, everything has been monitored. When did Juliet come in? When did Romeo come in? When were they first seen mating? When was the first incubation date? The hatch date due? This is crazy good information. You know, we can do statistics on this. Is incredible. When was the pip confirmed? So usually when the pip comes, until we see it, could be a few hours delay, but they do get up fairly frequently. So the pip, the confirmed pip, is very critical information. How long did the hatch take? Somewhere around, it could be between 1 day and 2 days. All the information is in here. What is their gestation dates? How many hatchlings were they? I think they have consistently, except for 1 year, they always have two. And they've always been successful. There has been not one single non-viable egg here. Really amazing information. How many weeks did they take to branch, to fledge? How long did the parents stay there? And so on and so on. Marvelous. And there's her name, by the way, right at the bottom. Oh, sorry. I must just make sure. The information seems to be stuck. One second. Something is going on at the moment. I cannot. Let me just try and reconnect here. The information is not coming across. So it just seems to be stuck here. My apologies. I'm not sure why. But it's not that important. It's not that important.
There we go. Now the page is working again. Okay, it's fine. It's working. It was a bit stuck, but now it's fine. But you can see it goes all the way to 2018. And what's interesting, when you come to 2018, you can see that we are a bit early. Because if you look at the column here on the pip confirmed, the pip was confirmed last year, mid-December. So we are about, what is it today? The 8th. So we are about 8 days early today. We're 8 days earlier. That's interesting. Now you'll say to me, well, let's look at the other data and let's find out maybe there's a reason why it's early. And this is where you have to be very careful. Don't jump to conclusions. But you could say, well, let's see when Romeo and Juliet arrived at the nest. Does that have anything to do with the, with the pip date or anything? I'm just speculating here just to show you. So we can see that Romeo was first seen at the nest this year on the 26th and of August, and Juliet on the 27th. But the answer is we don't really know if there's any correlation. Now, what is wonderful about the work that Gretchen has done, and that's why I would encourage everyone to do similar statistics. Don't go into speculation. I see the thing global warming. We really don't know. I want to be very scientific here. But we can start seeing correlations from this type of information the more the statistics grows. Imagine we did similar statistics on every single eagle cam nest. If we could do that, we would, in 10 years, we would have very valuable information. And probably this type of information is hidden somewhere. Someone knows it from other cameras. If we could consolidate that information into a huge data sheet, we would understand a lot more about the behavior of eagles and how it varies. If it's the same pair, what influence they have, when the first pip has come, and so on. At the moment, you have to be very careful when you look at these correlations. But I love statistics, and I would love to analyze this already and give you some data on that. But this is why this is so and so important. So let me jump quickly into some statistics here. David Hancock, let me just put the view a little bit different here and let's picture again. Okay, so let's talk a bit about David Hancock for a second. David Hancock was the person who first put in eagle cams in North America. He was the first one. I think it was way back in 2005, 2006, and at that time there was a complete overload. This had never been seen before, and they didn't have the bandwidth, so the complete system crashed. But he has been meticulously recording it from all the different eagle nests in around Vancouver for many years. So we have incredibly valuable information. Now, if we can evaluate that information, he has told me that the behavior of eagles has really changed over the years. When he started as a small boy many years ago with his float plane, he got this first float plane, I think at the age of 16 or 17, he afforded it. And then he went all across northern Canada into Alaska, and he was going into every single and every single valley looking for eagles. At that time, there were very few eagles. You know, the problem they had with DDT, and then they had the bounty on eagles, really a crazy bad time for eagles. But the eagles recovered. At that time, the eagles would not have a nest about a mile apart. Now, with the urbanization of the eagle and the fast adaptation, and fortunately, the eagle is not an endangered species anymore, they build their nests much closer. So their behavior has changed. And now we have the possibility to get all that information from all the data, from all of you who can do citizen science, right across North America. Imagine the value that science gets, and all the eagle biologists and so on, the fish and wildlife and all that. If we give that information to them, this is very valuable to tracing and understanding eagles, right? And especially in combination with cameras. So that is why it would be great if we could consolidate and store that information for all the different cameras. I think that would be a tremendous goal for 2018, wouldn't you agree? To do something what Belladonna has done, Nicole's information, what Gretchen has done, and so on. And I'm sure on the Southwest Florida Eagle Nest, there's also incredible information. Yes, David Hancock. If you don't know David Hancock, look up David Hancock, Hancock Wildlife Foundation, marvelous. And it will be one of the nests, one of the many nests that we will cover as the season goes on, okay? So you will learn a lot more about David Hancock. Okay, so we've gone through the nests. We've gone through this incredible Northeast Florida nest with its big, with its big chat rooms. Barry has a large chat room. Southwest has a big chat room. And you probably remember that last year, the Southwest Florida nest became so famous because just on Christmas Day, if I remember correctly, I think it was the 31st of December, where one of the eaglets hatched and the other egg wasn't viable. I remember that from the Southwest Florida, but it went right across the US, the news. It was incredible. So isn't that beautiful when one can celebrate eagles like that? Really, really incredible. So yes, Christian would love the data collected by Audubon Florida. Yes, and if I could have access to that, as I say, I'm very much a scientist. My background is physics. I have a PhD in physics and electrical engineering. But to do statistics on things is very, you have to do it very carefully. But it's something that is really important. It's from the citizen science. That's what you are doing everywhere, through photographs, through observations and so on. All this information, to consolidate information, is worth so much for the preservation of nature. That's it. That's it in a nutshell. So I always promised you something beautiful right at the end. So this time, and there's so many topics I can cover, but let me talk a little about, how about talking a little bit? Ah, there's eaglewatch@audubon.com. That's it, right? Thank you. Thank you, T-Rex. Oh, no, not T-Rex. It's K-Rex wrote. Okay, got it. Thank you. Very nice. Okay, so let's jump. Let me jump into eagle photography now. So just give me a second. I wanted to share some of my wisdom with you. So let me just find my page here. Yeah, here we go. So let me share some of my eagle photography wisdom with you. And for those who are interested, in January and February, I will be doing some personalized tours here in British Columbia around Vancouver. I will show you the best eagle areas. We will do incredible eagle photography, and I will give you incredible information that is valuable. If that's something that's interests you, just hold your breath. I'm organizing this for the first time now.
So I will be showing you those areas and also to get these type of quality photos that I've been doing. Okay, I'm not trying to sell my photos. I'm just trying to give you information that, that for those of you who are not so experienced with eagle photography. But this comes, let's jump into Haines, Alaska now. This was taken 2-3 years ago in Haines, Alaska. Now the problem you have about eagles, and let me just make myself a little bit smaller here. Yeah, there we go. The problem you have with eagle photography is you got a very white head and you got a very black body. So you have such a thing that's called the exposure meter. The exposure meter in most cameras are ridiculously good. You need a quality camera. Not anymore. The lens is more important than the camera. It really is. So I focused the camera just at the head. Okay, just at the head. And I did an exposure, and then I did another exposure, I did another exposure just at the body. Now look what happens. The head is completely overexposed and the body now comes out. So, let me just drink some water. So you can see what the problem here is. To get the exposure right is not easy. The advice I have for you is take the exposure of the head. Take the exposure of the head because that gives you the maximum. And it's better to use the exposure of the head because if you have an overexposed image, there's nothing you can save. If you have an underexposed image, there's still a lot you can do. If your camera is not too noisy, you can pull out all the beautiful parts, and I can go into that in different sessions, but you can pull that out. So always concentrate on the eagle's head if you do an exposure, rather the first exposure than a second one. And then really important for eagle photography is you are composing art. It's all about art, right? And there's nothing more beautiful than looking at how an eagle sits in a pine tree. So the beauty here is not necessarily only the eagle. It is, you can see the tree and it gives you sort of a frosty cold atmosphere, right? And that's what you're looking for. That's what you're looking for. So I took the exposure here of the eagle's head and just brought out the darkness a little bit from the, from the background. And then you get this incredible exposure, right? Should we always use raw setting? Yes, Sasha, you should. If you can shoot raw. Now, what does Nicole mean by raw? She means by raw, you have the options of using JPEG. And I hope I'm not gonna take off now. JPEG are 8-bit 8-bit deep. Then you have TIFFs, which are 16-bit. And then you have RAW. RAW means that the camera is not processing the image internally. That means you have all the degrees of freedom to change your white balance and all these things later. So it's important to do images in RAW. Yes, good point. Let's jump a little bit on. Now, this was another one I did in Haines and Alaska. The art of doing eagle photography is two things. Look at the light and look at the wind. Look at the light and look at the wind. Always have your back to the wind if you can. The wind, and that's actually very nice because you don't want the wind to blow into the camera. It's very unpleasant. But always rotate so that your back is that's where the wind is blowing into, and your face is nicely into the direction then for where the wind is coming. Why? Because eagles take off like airplanes, exactly the same. It's not that airplanes learned this from eagles. Eagles didn't learn this from airplanes, but eagles naturally do it. You'll see that even, you know what is really funny? You will see that even when eaglets poop from the nest, they always turn properly away when they poop so that the that poop stream does not go back into the nest. They intuitively do this correctly, the same way that they intuitively face into the wind just like an airplane, and then they take off and they do that. Thank you. It's a beautiful photograph, and it just shows this ink. I love it
when you see the feather structure, you see all the primaries, right? The primaries beautifully stretched out. Those are the tips of the wing. And you can see they're putting on full brakes as this bird is landing. So that's the art. And if sometimes you are lucky that you can face that you have the sun in the back, especially in the early morning or the evening, the sun in the back and the wind coming from the back, that is the perfect situation. And I can offer this to you, by the way, in White Rock. In May, I can offer you the sun coming from the back in the morning and the wind coming sometimes from the back. And that gives this beautiful photography that you can have where the eagle lands right in front of you and you get the most incredible images, okay? Should I ever zoom into auto settings or... Okay, wait. Sasha says, should you ever zoom in with auto settings or yourself through viewfinder? I'm not sure what your question is. I'm not sure what your question is, Sasha, but auto settings are not good. The typical settings that you're looking at is run it on auto ISO, because usually ISO you can leave free. What you need to watch out for is focus, focus, focus. Use your autofocus. Always try and focus on the eagle's eye if you can. Always focus on the eagle's eye, because if you can focus on the eagle's eye, you get it sharp, right? That's usually what I do. And I'm not going to talk about back focus and other things. That goes a little bit too far. But see that you focus and you put the shutter speed, and that's really important. The shutter speed for landing and takeoff for eagles should be at least 1/1000th of a second. Better is 1/1600th of a second. Then you can get because the feathers are also moving during flight, and they move much faster. They vibrate, and you can freeze all that with about 1/1200th of a second, 1/1600th of a second. You don't need to go faster, okay? Yes, you want your back in the sun. That's exactly right. So let me show you a few more. That's an eagle landing. Very nice again. I got a very nice angle from the side, and you can see the feather structure comes in beautiful. Now comes the thing that I talked about, and these are the type of things I can offer you in White Rock. Look at where the sun is coming from. The sun is coming from my back, and the wind is coming from the back, and you get this incredible illumination from the sun, which is magical. You can only get this in the morning and the evenings, right? You have to be really early. And you get this feather structure, and the feathers look shiny, they look polished. You get this amazing detail, right? Amazing details. And sometimes you get an eagle from very close, right? You get it very close. Shutter speed is about 1/1000th of a second, okay? So sometimes you get an eagle really close. That was a huge female, not shouting at me, okay? She was not upset with me, she was upset with other eagles, but I had my huge 800 millimeter just looking straight at me. And this is another photograph. Again, look at the angle of the sun and the wind, okay? So again, that is the same, you know, the same trick landing. You get this beautiful feather structure, all right? This is taken from the bottom. Very interesting, by the way. Not good illumination, but I just lit up. I brought out the shadows. And again, it has its, it has its attraction, because you can, even though it was dark, the camera's noise level was very low, and I was able to do that. And sometimes you get these really tranquil situations, as if this eagle was leaning against a tree, really beautiful. Its head just in the shade. You can see it's beautifully in the shade, and just the wing slightly illuminated, right? It's a beautiful composition. What is really magic in photography is the play between shadows and light, okay? It's the meticulous changing, the shimmering that you have through the leaves that give you beautiful compositions, right? And it's such things that give you magic in photography. And I don't invent these things, I just see them, right? And you see them too. I've seen beautiful photographs there, okay? So this is what you can do. And this is rather another nice photograph, because the eagle's just turning towards me there. You can see, beautifully turning towards me. Again, light in the morning, and
If you zoom this in, which I'll do now, you can see the incredible details, right? The incredible details of the wing structure and so on. So it's as if it was just flying towards me, right? All to do with the wind. Really, really lucky shot, right? And then you, of course, get these incredible shots where you get the mirror. And now this is not a Photoshop mirror. This is a real one. I don't Photoshop mirror. I don't do that. This is a real natural mirror where an eagle landed in White Rock on a rock, and the rock looks like a pyramid. And when I zoom in, you can see how beautiful the details here are, really beautiful details. The wings come out again because the light is coming from the back in the early morning. And there's this eagle magnificently landing on this rock. And there you can see the reflection. Okay, so I think that's enough for now. I think I have inspired you a little bit. Maybe one quick word about the water. I think I'll talk a little bit about the water eagle. Okay, so this, why did I create the water eagle? Well, the water eagle is, of course, a Photoshop version that I did myself because I took, and I can explain that in my courses one day, how I did this. I took an eagle's head and I looked at the wing structure and made it disappear and superimposed with brushes very carefully it in water. And it just gives this incredible dynamic feeling of an eagle landing in water. Okay, so that's my own creation. As I said, I'm not an artist. I don't claim I'm the worst with the pen that you can imagine. But I do know I can see things. That's what I can see things. Yes, this is Photoshop. Of course, it's Photoshop. But it has to be. But it's a creation in Photoshop that is taken from a real image. And as you can see, and I what I did is I superimposed water over it to just use the detail, so it's a created image, but it's just nice. It's just nice. Okay, so anyway, I let me just go out, get out of the way so you can see it. But on that note, I think I've taken 50 minutes of your time. I wanted to thank you so much for participating again. I'm absolutely grateful. Next session we'll either do the Decora Nest or we'll do the DC, or maybe both, okay? So I'll keep this up, showing regular news. I so enjoy it when you participate. Do spread the news and do subscribe. Just press the subscribe. You'll get my regular updates. And as the eagle season increases, I hope to do broadcasts in the morning too, okay? So when of course some say, well, why are you doing this in the evenings? You can't see the eagle nest. Yes, of course, I get the argument, but it's a compromise between your time when you have time. It's always in the evenings where people work and they have more time for live broadcasts. And then I may add over the weekend some morning broadcasts too, so that we can, you know, I can share different cameras with you and you can give your comments, right? So do send me your photographs. Do send me everything that you want to send. Do spread the news and let's do some statistics. As I said, I would appreciate volunteers from the Barry, Southwest and Northeast Florida nest. Those are the big nests. If there's anybody who can send me information, sassephoto@gmail.com, I would really be delighted. I'm delighted to show your pictures, to share whatever. You are the ones who really make this work. And I always look forward to Friday. It's fantastic. And as I said, we'll increase this. And let's keep a careful watch and let's make this a successful eagle year, right? So thank you so much for joining, and do write to me and let's keep it up. Okay, so I wish you a wonderful weekend, and and thank you for joining. So many people coming in, and I really so much appreciate it. So I'll stop streaming now, and I look forward to seeing you very soon. Thank you so much.